This is BBC One in the South East. Now the news at 10 o'clock with Peter Sissons and Mike Embley.
The campaign's over, now the leaders wait for the nation to decide. Tony Blair's final appeal, get out and vote or you'll get William Hague. William Hague hits back, the forces of conservatism are on the march. Charles Kennedy says Britain will need a strong opposition, led by him. The other headlines, Michael Barrymore questioned about drugs after a man dies at his home. A night of rioting in Leeds, police say it was a planned criminal attack. And Blast of the Mohicans, a win in Athens raises England's World Cup hopes.
In the southeast, 7 murders, 50 shootings in 6 months. Police promise an all-out assault on gun crime. And the holidaymaker killed in Turkey. At last, a suspect could face trial.
Good evening. There's nothing more the politicians can do except wait for the verdict. But pounding across the country, none of them was wasting the last precious hours before the campaign curtain came down. For Tony Blair, the next biggest enemy to the Tories was apathy. William Hague saw hope in the forces of conservatism, famously derided by the Prime Minister, having their revenge. Charles Kennedy pressed the case to the last for better public services and a beefed-up opposition, led by him. Andrew Marr on the campaign's final hours.
It's nearly over now. For Britain's political leaders, the shattering 4-week marathon ends tonight. From tomorrow morning, it's over to the voters. But beyond the enthusiasts, will we make the effort? Tony Blair's message all day was simple. Just do it.
Put that cross on the ballot paper for economic strength and stability, low mortgages, more jobs. Put that cross on the ballot paper for extra investment in our public services. Put that cross on the ballot paper for the help for pensioners and families continuing. Put that cross on the ballot paper for taking this country forward, for building on what we've started, and for not going back to the years of conservative instability, cuts in services, and social division.
So started a day of hectically crisscrossing the country, singing out familiar tunes to all those people still unsure or who don't yet care. Labour, as here in Dumfries, also needs to get its core heartland voters out.
So please, on estates like this, these are the places where people have got to come out, where people have got to understand that it's their voice that is heard, it's their decision tomorrow.
At times, Labour's poll lead has made its campaign seem more like carnival than fight. But Tony Blair, by now in Yorkshire, seems close up, like a man haunted by lack of time, urgent, pressured.
Remember that phrase, there is no such thing as society? Well, what we've learned and what we know is there is such a thing as society. So come out and support that strong society. Support giving decent chances to everyone in our country. Support that brighter, better future. Yes, it's tough. Of course it's difficult. We won't do it overnight. We never could. But we've begun. We've laid foundations. Give us your support and your strength to carry on what we started. Thank you.
Good morning. Good morning. Good morning.
And here's the man determined to stop him. William Hague began his day with London meat porters. He doesn't like political correctness. He'd come to the right place.
Get him out.
Thank you very much. Get him out.
You're better looking in real life.
Oh, here we go.
Then breakfast, full English. Mr. Hague is not a man who ever willingly chooses the continental option. The Tories' final rally in London felt more like Britain's blind date, as the party's leading lights described their personal journeys.
I was attracted to Labour as a young man, as a very young man. I used to believe that all that talk of high taxation and high public spending was socially responsible. But as time has gone by, I've seen why it doesn't work.
But after the autobiography is the political punch. Remember Mr. Blair's famous attack on the right?
His attack on the forces of conservatism and his attempt to heap all the ills and evils of the 20th century on the heads of decent people must rank as one of the most ill-judged political attacks of all time. And tomorrow the world will find out that the forces of conservatism are on the march.
And they've been marching in this campaign to save the pound, despite the critics still for Mr. Hague what matters most.
Here in Winchester, the coins of our nation were minted for a very long time. That is part of the history of our country and part of the history of Winchester. These people who you see with Labour posters want to destroy the independence of our country in the next 2 years.
Mr. Hague is finding affection on the streets, whatever's going on behind his back.
That's why
Charles Kennedy, having moved to Labour's left on many issues, is at last able to explain his politics with a simple clarity Liberal Democrats have often struggled for.
So tomorrow, for the electorate, there are three choices. If you want investment in education and schools and pensions to remain the same, then probably you should go and support Labour. If you want it to get worse, vote for William Hague's Conservatives. But if you want more investment in education and pensions, cast a vote for the Liberal Democrats.
The Lib Dems are awful at razzmatazz. A few yellow balloons are their idea of media manipulation. This may explain their growing popularity.
This election isn't a referendum on Europe or the Euro. It's not about some of the outrageous claims and counterclaims the other two have been making. This is a chance for the public to record their view about the quality of our public services in this country.
Throughout this campaign, the two bigger parties have barely bothered to notice Mr. Kennedy. Has that proved a mistake?
If you think about it, we're now standing at a higher level in the opinion polls with only 24 hours to go for any general election, getting on for the best part of two decades.
Tonight, the Commons is deserted, a political shell. For as long as the ballot boxes are open tomorrow, power lies where it's always supposed to, in the hands of the people. Andrew Marr, BBC News, Westminster.
The leader of the Scottish National Party, John Swinney, has said that only a vote for his party can save the health service in Scotland. Mr. Swinney said that his party's MPs could be relied upon to campaign at Westminster on Scotland's behalf.
Scotland needs to have strong SNP voices at Westminster to protect our share of health spending, which is already under pressure, and we have the worst health record in Europe. So we've got to make sure we have strong SNP voices that will stand for Scotland at Westminster, and I'm determined to gain seats and votes in the election on Thursday.
And the Welsh nationalist leader, Ieuan Wynne-Jones, said that Plaid Cymru was the only party able to stand up for Wales.
It's only us that is offering a real alternative to New Labour. New Labour that's adopted Conservative policies, and Plaid Cymru fighting a very positive campaign to improve the economy of Wales and also to invest in our public services, health, education and decent pensions.
All three major party leaders spent the day in one last dash, taking in some of their target seats and some of their strongholds. Charles Kennedy travelled the furthest, going west, then north, and then into Scotland before reaching home in Fort William. William Hague went south before heading through the East Midlands and into his native Yorkshire. Tony Blair started his day in the Midlands, stopping in Clwyd, Derbyshire, Dumfries and Pontefract before returning to Sedgefield. We have reports on the very last stages of all three leaders' campaigns, first on Tony Blair's arrival tonight at Trimdon Labour Club.
The journey's end. Tony Blair back in his Sedgefield constituency. This was where he laid out his philosophy for the campaign in one of the opening speeches, and where he draws that campaign to a close. Joined by local MPs and members of his staff, his face etched with fatigue and relief, he asked his local party to help him make history.
It is here, in our constituency, where the changes in the Labour Party began, that we ask for this historic second term for a Labour government. Not because of seeking office, not because of simply holding the position, but because we believe that we have begun something important for our country and we ask to be given the chance to carry it on.
Come on! Come on! Come on!
Encouragement for England in their World Cup qualifier, their winning style widely seen here as a good omen for Tony Blair. But tomorrow is the moment when the public will pass their judgment on his performance and the extent to which Labour have lived up to the high expectations that they themselves encouraged. Carolyn Quinn, BBC News, with the Prime Minister in Sedgefield.
And Carolyn Quinn's in Sedgefield now. Carolyn, I suppose you're at the temporary centre of government. What's going on?
Well, Tony Blair is staying in the constituency tonight. Tomorrow he will go with his family to cast his vote. I said there in my report that the football result was a good omen. I don't know about the weather. I'm sure they'll be hoping that it does improve tomorrow. Certainly the Blair team very upbeat tonight, full of smiles, despite that talk of landslide earlier on in the campaign. But Tony Blair himself still seems to be driven by this inner turmoil. He is concerned that he may not be the person to take Labour into that historic second term. He certainly wants to do it, and he wants to do it well.
Carolyn Quinn, thank you. A short time ago, William Hague ended his longest day in Richmond, North Yorkshire. He's remained upbeat throughout the campaign, and tonight was no exception.
By the time William Hague and his battle bus arrived in rainy Richmond tonight, the final stop of the campaign, the Tory leader had travelled 10,000 miles and visited 60 constituencies. The party faithful were on hand to greet the homecoming Hagues, who covered 550 miles just today.
Mr Hague, has the campaign been as good as you wanted it to be?
Very good indeed.
Mr Hague's supporters gave him a rousing reception, and in return he told them the Conservative deserved to win.
That is why the Conservative Party has waged a united, energetic and cohesive campaign, to the dismay of some commentators, but nevertheless it has done so. And that is why, in the face of all the criticism that's been levelled at us and the occasional abuse, we have carried on with our campaign, because we have been buoyed up and spurred on by the reaction of people around the country.
Mr Hague left Richmond Town Hall and drove into the night, buoyed by a standing ovation. Now he must await the voters' verdict. Laura Trevelyan, BBC News, Richmond.
And Laura Trevelyan is in Richmond now. Laura, what are William Hague's plans?
Well, he's going home to enjoy, I imagine, a relaxing drink with his wife, celebrating the end of a gruelling campaign. And then he's going to vote tomorrow morning. He's also going to actually telephone some voters tomorrow to encourage them to go to the polls. But it's an interesting mood here tonight from William Hague and his camp. They're defiantly upbeat. They believe against the odds they fought a good campaign. They know that the polls suggest they're staring disaster in the face, but they maintain the belief that they've done the best they can, and they hope the result will be better than the opinion polls suggest.
Laura Trevelyan, thank you. Charles Kennedy's campaign trail ended tonight in the Scottish Highlands. He'll spend Election Day at his home in Fort William.
He's travelled 15,000 miles over the past 4 weeks. After zigzagging the country, Charles Kennedy headed north for his last campaign stop, an Edinburgh shopping centre.
Make a wish for the election.
His wish is to improve his party's tally of 47 seats. He says he's being honest with voters when he tells them that better public services can only come through higher taxes. Tonight, the final flight of Charles Kennedy's campaign brought him home to Fort William in the Highlands. After nearly 20 years as an MP, he's experienced the highs and lows of third-party politics. In this election, the Liberal Democrats have been moving steadily upwards in the polls.
Fingers and toes crossed. People go out and match their comments to us with their ballots in the polling booth, then I think we're online for more votes and more seats in the next House of Commons.
Charles Kennedy's campaign slogan has been, "What you see is what you get." This election is his first test as Lib Dem leader. By this time tomorrow, the voters will have decided whether he succeeds in his ambition of heading a strong opposition party. June Kelly, BBC News, Fort William.
And June Kelly is still in Fort William. June, what's the picture at the Kennedy camp?
Well, Peter, I should say first that I'm speaking to you through a haze of midges, which is one of the lesser attractive features of life in Fort William. The mood in the Kennedy camp is very buoyant indeed. They say their private polling reflects the public polls, and they are taking votes from both Tories and Labour. It has to be said, of course, that there have been false dawns before for the Liberal Democrats. Tomorrow, Mr Kennedy plans to spend the day quietly. He will be out and about in his constituency of Ross Skye and Inverness West a bit, but then he plans to come home here, spend the day relaxing, sleeping, we're told, and possibly possibly even doing some gardening. I'm not sure whether it'll be gardening weather up here tomorrow, but then he'll go off to his count and wait for the results to come in.
June Kelly, thank you. And swatting the midges, no doubt. You mentioned the polls there. The last polls of the campaign suggest Labour's lead has narrowed but remains strong. Here's Peter Snow with a final look at the figures.
Peter, the race ends closer than it began. Labour's lead has fallen, but if the polls are reflected in the outcome tomorrow, and that's an important if, then Mr Blair's heading for another landslide and expects surprises from the Lib Dems. Morrie in the Times tomorrow, polling yesterday and today, has Labour finishing on 45, the Tories on 30, and the Liberal Democrats on 18. Gallup in the Daily Telegraph, polling today only and still counting, puts Labour on 48, the Tories on 32, and the Lib Dems on 16. So here are all the polls from the start until today, including ICM in this morning's Guardian that gave Labour its lowest lead of the campaign. Add tonight's two polls, which show no last-minute shift, and the broad trend is a 19-point Labour lead at the start here, narrowing to 15 points on the eve of polling day, and the Lib Dems ending on 18. Over the campaign, Labour are down 5, the Tories down 1, the Liberal Democrats up by 5, and the others up 1. And this is matched by what people think of the campaigns. NOP asked whether people were impressed, first, by the Liberal Democrats. Yes, said 48%. 36% said no, a 12% lead for those who were impressed. Labour's campaign scored 48% too, but gave 41% gave it the thumbs down, a plus of 7%. But the Tory campaign impressed only 24%. And left 65% unimpressed, a minus score of 41%. Back to the prospects for tomorrow. The latest polls suggest a 1% swing to Labour, and last time's majority of 179 could be even greater. But the polls have exaggerated Labour's strength in the past. They did in 1997. And if you allow for that, you get a 0.5% swing to the Tories. And allowing for the biggest ever error in 1992, would take the swing to 3%. That would still leave Labour with a hefty majority of over 100. All the latest polls estimate turnout will be down, but nobody's certain who will be damaged, Peter.
Now, the BBC's political editor, Andrew Marr, joins us from Westminster. Andrew, all our party leaders have been dashing around, as you pointed out, afraid almost to stop. Is it purely a last day ritual, or does it have some meaning?
I think it's a little bit more than a ritual, though. Of course, it's partly what we call displacement activity. There's nothing left to say, so they might as well be travelling. But I think it's more than that. They are scrabbling around, even at this last stage, for every vote. There is a kind of alchemy, a sort of magic going on in the democratic process, whereby each vote, every little cross, is a sort of fragment of authority. And when they are added together, somebody achieves massive power, huge power over the fourth largest economy in the world, power over nuclear weapons, power to strut the world stage. And right at the end of this campaign, I think they're all caught up in this. They realise that a lot of their activity today is only for the cameras, and yet every vote does count, they all feel it, and somebody tomorrow will be rewarded with this extraordinary, democratic, relatively rare authority.
Andrew Marr, thank you. Well, now the rest of the news. The television entertainer Michael Barrymore has been released on police bail tonight. He'd been questioned. We could be
Earlier today, I saw the Queen at Buckingham Palace to ask for a dissolution of Parliament so that there could be a general election on the 7th of June.
Brown beer. Brown bear, what do you see?
So my partner has cancer. So what are you going to do?
I mean, I'm me and John's John, and I tell you, you know, he has got very, very great strength. Not least in his left arm.
Somebody should have told him that Hit Me Baby One More Time is not meant for the Labour Party's campaign theme tune.
And it turns out that
that you were expecting me after all, for the billboards read, "The Mummy Returns."
Me and Sid agree to differ.
Yeah. You're going to vote for Baldy and I'm voting for the handsome <Hansen. laughs>
So we've committed to what we're doing in Scotland, which is...
Where have you been hiding?
It's taken up until week three to have more than one token woman on the platform, and I think I'm right in saying this is the first time that one of them has been allowed to even answer a question.
I don't think you're accurate. Sorry, Estelle, but I don't think you're...
Rydw i fod yn ôl yma yn y gogledd, a mae'r Highland Tony arno ni.
And David Dimbleby will present the BBC's election results programme tomorrow night on Vote 2001, The Verdict, starting at 9.55 on BBC One. Well, it's just after 28 minutes to 11. I'll be back a little later with an update on the day's headlines. But now we join our news teams across the UK.